Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here with you in the beautiful city of Spelunga and on this outstanding colloquium. I'm the second author of this talk. The first author is Professor Holnicki Schulz, who unfortunately couldn't take part in this colloquium. And the third author is Mr. Arkadiusz Mróz. We come from Poland. This is the outline of the talk. Basically, I would like to discuss a family of semi-active techniques for mitigation of vibrations, which we call energy management techniques. This talk will be much different from the previous talk because I will show no closed form solutions, finding solutions, but much more. We are at the beginning of our research. Actually, a week ago, we have learned that we've been granted support for 3 years research in this topic, and we look for a PhD student to work full time on it. So it will be much more a collection of problems, ideas, and approaches to formalization, and some ad hoc numerical examples. When you think about mitigation of vibrations, we have two extremes. On one hand, we have passive systems, and on the other hand, we have active systems. In passive systems, we have no actuators. All we can do is we can perform certain topological optimization of the structure and optimize damping properties of its elements. In active systems, we have the principle of active counteraction to vibrations performed by dedicated actuators. These systems are very researched and, as we have seen in the first lecture, very effective, but it comes at the cost of relatively high control forces and potential for instabilities in case of failure. Somewhere in between these extremes, we have semi-active control systems like the MR-DEMPES we have just heard about. And here, they are based on the idea of self-adaptation of the structure or of the actuators, which do adapt their own mechanical properties to the measured response of the structure. Here we have no injection of external energy into the structure, which means that we have no large control forces, we have low power consumption, and basically no potential for instabilities. And our techniques do belong to semi-active family of techniques. We call them adaptive management of energy because they are based on three steps or phases. So we have storage of energy, either of the potential energy or strain energy of the deforming members of the structure, or of the kinetic energy, namely the rotational, in the form of rotational inertia of dedicated elements. Then we have the phase of redistribution of energy. Basically, the energy is released or transferred by dynamic structural reconfiguration, either into higher order structural modes of vibration, or to dissipative, dedicated dissipative elements in an on-off strategy or bank-bank strategy. And finally, we have dissipation of this energy, either by material damping, standard mechanism of material damping, which is high in higher order modes, or in dedicated dissipative elements. We will start, we have started our research with semi-active management of potential energy. Here, the energy is stored in the deforming elements and released into higher order vibration modes by local reconfiguration of the structure. We consider two kinds of actuators. So the first kind are controllable nodes, which are capable of a controllable transition between a truss-like mode, so no zero moment bearing capability, and a frame-like mode with the full moment bearing ability. The other type of actuators we do consider, or we intend to consider, are just disconnectable elements, which are able either to be in the connected state, or which could be also disconnected with free ability of deformation. This corresponds to zero or infinite yield stress for typical elastoplastic elements. And dissipation takes form of just standard material damping in higher order modes, which are highly damped. We think about technological realization of such modes. Oh, the first, probably the first idea we come across is the dry friction and system of pretensioning springs. And indeed, it's a good idea to base verification of ad hoc strategies in commercial codes like Abaqus using such this kind of system. These are figures from a paper that is just in review. But if we think about formalization of the problem and deriving certain general rules or properties of the optimum control, we need a model that's as simple as possible. So we have decided to start with a frame, two-dimensional frame model, with in which the semi-active nodes are capable of on-demand aggregation and deaggregation of the rotational degrees of freedom. Aggregated state corresponds to the frame node, deaggregated states corresponds to the truss mode of operation. So modeling of such aggregation deaggregation is possible in several ways. So the first way is the virtual distortion method by Professor Holnitsky, and the other way we have started with is just by increasing, significantly increasing, the damping of the relative motion of the rotational degrees of freedom. The first approach is better because it's more exact. It's exact. It allows us to model aggregation exactly, but it leads quite complicated formulas. So we have started with this other approach, which is inexact, because even in the aggregated state, we have basically a mechanism, but it leads to simpler formulas, which are much easier to deal with. So this is our semi-active node, a frame, two-dimensional frame, which connects three elements. At the stage of assembly of global matrices, we do aggregate translational modes of freedom, but we do not aggregate rotational degrees of freedom. We only couple them by damping matrix of this form, this here formulated in rotational degrees of freedom. So basically we can couple the, we can damp the relative motion of the rotational degrees of freedom. If you look at the global equation of motion for the free vibration case, we obtain something like that. And our goal basically is determination of the optimum time evolution of the control functions alpha, which do affect only the stiffness matrix. So this means that we are within the realm of bilinear control systems. And our tool of choice is the Pontryagin minimum principle, which requires the system to be formulated in the state space form. Our goal is mitigation of vibrations, so we need for that purpose certain objective function, and we have decided to use just the mean total energy of the structure. We have three vibrations, mean total energy of the structure within certain time interval. And Pontryagin minimum principle, by Pontryagin minimum principle, we learn that the optimum bounded open loop control is of the bang-bang type. So optimum control must attain only the lower or the upper bound of the this allowable range, according to a certain function here, which quite informally can be called a gradient of the objective function with respect to the control functions. So this notion needs to be formalized, but basically it's kind of a quasi-gradient. In this function, we have state variables z, but also the co-state variables w, which have to satisfy an adjoint system or the co-state system of equations. And here two important points should be noticed. So first, this system of these two equations, which are coupled, is a boundary value problem, because the state equation has the initial value specified, and the co-state equation has the final value specified. And the second thing to notice is that the co-state equation, in mechanical terms, corresponds to a mechanical system, which is exactly the same as our original system, but has negative damping, and is subject to certain pseudo-excitation. So it has negative damping, and as we would like to focus on higher order, highly damped modes, it means that we cannot integrate this system forward in time, because our trajectories would quickly diverge. All we can do is we can integrate it backward in time, starting from the final time point. It means also that we cannot integrate forward in time the whole coupled system of both equations just to compute the optimum control strategy. We can only assume certain control function, integrate the system forward to obtain the response, then integrate the co-system backward to obtain this quasi-gradient and verify the optimality of the assumed control strategy. So to perhaps back here. So this is all true for this kind of the objective function. We could or we can analyze other objective functions. The most important of them would be the minimum time objective function, but it will lead to a much more complex co-system with mixed initial and final time boundary conditions, which would be numerically quite intractable. So we need, I think, now to use this objective function, which is quite reasonable. Okay, to summarize the Pondragi minimum principle, without it, we can only assume the control function and compute the value of the objective function for brute force zero-order optimization. But the Pondragi minimum principle provides us with two important tools. So first, the knowledge that the optimum open loop bounded control is the bank-bank type, so we do not need to bother with continuous control functions. And the other thing is the quasi-gradient function, which it provides, which is can be used in a strong, really strong necessary condition of optimality. Okay, and numerical example. This numerical example is still an ad hoc numerical example performed using dry friction-based damper and an intuitively derived control function, which is still very effective. So the purpose of optimization, formalization optimization, would be to obtain an even better efficiency and apply the control in the case of more complex structures and more complex modes of vibration. So this is our structure, a two-dimensional frame, which vibrates with an opening panel attached to it on a hinge. The source of vibration is a blast which initiates opening of the panel and the angular velocity profile of opening of the panel. So it's kind of a model perhaps of a certain deployable structure. And the green modes are the semi-active modes capable of truss frames transition. At the beginning we have considered all modes to be semi-active. Our ad hoc or intuitively derived control strategy consists of two phases. The first phase is energy transfer and dissipation. We start in the frame mode, so the structure vibrates mostly in its first vibration mode. Upon detection of the maximum vertical displacement, we release the strain energy, which is accumulated in the both layers, into horizontal energy of vibrations, which are of much higher frequency. Just by going for a short period of time to the truss mode. So we go up, for example, we then release the energy to horizontal vibrations and block the structure again in the frame mode. Then second phase comes on, is the return to more or less initial configuration. The remaining energy that has still remained in the basic mode forces the structure to go down according to the first vibration mode. And then we gradually release the modes to the truss, the nodes to the truss mode to allow return of the whole structure to more or less initial configuration. And here the results of the vertical displacements of the tip of the bottom layer. The panel here starts to open, it opens. We have then, after opening, we have certain remaining vibration of up and down of the structure. We initiate the control strategy, and we see that, in fact, the vibrations could be quickly and effectively damped with this kind of intuitive control. So we hope to even improve it or apply it for more complex vibration shapes by formal optimization. Here we have horizontal displacements of both tips of both upper and lower layers. We see that before the control, we have low frequency oscillations which correspond to the up and down motion of the first mode of vibration. And upon activation, here is the magnification, upon activation of the control strategy, the vibrations become of much higher frequency because the layers start to vibrate in this horizontal direction. And this mode of vibration is much higher damped by standard metrical vibration. We have tested also the same approach for a larger number of semi-active nodes used in simulations, starting from one and going up to seven pairs of nodes. And here are the results. Even with a single pair of semi-active nodes, we are able to quite quickly decrease the amplitude of vertical vibrations twofold. So these results are quite ad hoc and applied for a special case, but they are quite promising. So we hope we will get much more general and better results by performing formal analysis of the problem. So, conclusions. We intend to research semi-active techniques for management and redistribution of vibration energy. They seem to be a challenge in semi-active mitigation of vibrations. We have demonstrated that they are quite efficient in ad hoc numerical examples, and they can be formally addressed by means either of the virtual distortion method or just increased damping for modeling, and by the Pondra-Yagin minimum principle for deriving the optimum control functions. And the work is still in progress. So, thank you very much.
Any questions? Okay. I have seen similar things done by Professor Kohl in Stuttgart, who probably are familiar with this work. And I'm going to ask you the same question as I asked him. What is target application? Assuming what you do works, what are you going to do with it?
Okay.
Because he claims he can control precision structure, and I claim he cannot. So what about you?
Okay, what about me? So, okay, I will ask you about once again about the Professor Gorlitz? Professor Gorlitz? Professor Gaul, yes, Professor Gaul, sure. Professor Gaul from Stuttgart. So our initial structure was, we have a project, so we are active in a project by European Space Agency. We derive a damping system which damps vibration coming from initiation of a hydraulic system by a microblast. So our initial idea was to deal with vibration of space, of flexible space structures. But for me as a theoretical guy, it's just an interesting theoretical problem. But applications are, of course, also interesting and important. Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. Have you thought of some application to civil structures along the same question here? Okay. I think you can...
within so in the lab scale now we in our support we have received support for a project, and in our project we have a plan for performing laboratory tests using a frame structure of 5 or 6 meters long, but it will be our first step. Then we can perhaps think about civil engineering structures, but first we'd like to derive it on the theoretical level and then verify in lab, then we can go up.
Well, if no more questions, thank you very much.
Thank you.